Goedenavond, welkom bij Topnames. Iedere dinsdagavond vanuit Freedom Lab in Amsterdam. Te gast is Nelly Jerodar. Nelly, you're from Bundle Boon.
I am.
What do you do?
I'm the founder of Bundle Boon, which is a curated shopping service for children in the Netherlands. And it basically works like a normal personal shopping service that you see for men and women. But we do it for children instead.
And why did you decide to start doing that? Did you know there was a market for it? Normally you go to shops and you see nice stuff and you buy it. So why?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have any kids myself, but okay. I have a lot of people that in my network that do.
Yeah.
But I used to work for a similar concept here in the Netherlands called the Cloakroom.
Yeah, we had them in our show.
I know, that's weird. I worked for them for a couple of years, and because I was one of their early stage employees, I kind of got some really good insights to how the whole industry works. And then at the very end, I did some more research into how to make it more successful, be more innovative, and I saw some of the competitors that the Cloakroom had in the US, and they also did it for children. And the children segment actually outperformed the adults. So I figured kidswear is the fastest growing segment in the fashion industry at the moment. So, I mean, there might be a potential. And
explain to us how it works.
I'm a lazy parent. I don't want to go to the shop with my kids, so I think I'll go to Bundle Boon, and then
yes.
What happens?
So you go on our website and there is a quiz on there. You simply just press start and then a conversation with one of our stylists starts. And she will literally ask you about your children's size, preferences, the type of colors, budget as well. And then after a couple of days, preferably the same day, she will give you a call, ask you a few more questions just to make sure that she understood everything right. And then she will handpick two personalized outfits with some accessories. And she will write a really cute style note as well.
This is an example of what you receive at home.
That's an example, exactly.
Yeah.
And there's
so
around
hi, Rebecca and Charlie, and a special note, personal note. And a lot of clothes inside.
Yes. All based on the answers that you gave us in the quiz.
Yeah.
And then she ships it to your doorstep and you can use your living room as a runway for 5 working days. And the beauty of it all is that you only pay for the stuff that you want to keep.
Okay.
And the rest you send back free
of charge. You just send it back free of charge. Underwear.
There is some pants, there is some shirts in there, some socks. And then we nicely wrap it up as well and send it to you.
And you did do a lot of research. Mm-hmm. You said, why do people use your service? What is the most important thing for them not to go shopping themselves?
Right. So based on the research that we did, the market research that we did, a lot of parents find it a hassle to bring their kids to the stores.
Okay, yeah.
It's a whole weekend work, right? You have to plan it.
Yeah.
Plus, they also find it super difficult and time-consuming to find inspirational trends or brands that the next-door neighbor's kids don't wear. So
yeah,
it's the typical Zara, typical Biancorp, typical H&M. So we are basically the go-to place to find niche brands that the kid next door don't have.
And you can, like you said,
is it a specific type of parents? I mean, you said you did a lot of research, because to be honest with you, I would never, ever
use the service. We call them Instagram moms.
Instagram moms.
We call them Instagram moms.
Okay.
So that explains a lot. Yeah. So moms that typically like to dress their kids up and have them pose a little bit with the outfits. You know, parents that really enjoy a luxurious lifestyle and don't mind spending money on good branded clothes.
So it's really for the well-off. That's
mid to high annual income, yeah.
Because, for example, what's in this box? How much does it cost?
It's around 250 euros,
okay.
Approximately.
Yeah, but that's the whole box, and like you said, you can send back.
Yeah, you can also just choose one outfit. You can choose two items if you want to and send the rest back. The whole point with this concept is that as a parent, you don't have to go. I mean, parents love to shop online, general people do, but you don't have to go onto the traditional online shops and go through the what we call shitty filters, because it's a hassle. It takes a long time to find that perfect outfit. In fact, studies have shown it takes around 2.5 hours to find that perfect outfit that the parent actually wants.
Yeah, and you say it's personally curated. Mm-hmm. I remember that from cloakroom. Yeah. Of course, it doesn't really work like that because you have a limited amount of categories mm-hmm. of people, and they fit into one of the categories.
Right.
That's how it works, doesn't
right.
it? Yeah. How many do you have? Like 10 or 20?
You mean personas, like categories?
Yeah. Yeah.
We have 4 at the moment.
4.
And it works quite well. We're able to like categorize those children within the 4 categories, and we offer more than 50 brands, so mm-hmm. it's not a problem.
No. Yeah. And what have you, of course, you before we started, you said we haven't been going for a year yet.
Right, so 11 months.
So we don't know if we get the same people back when they're in the sort of same sort of season. But what have you learned in this first period of your company?
Well, that we have to listen to their budget, to parents' budget. Not everyone wants to spend 250 euros on a box, but they're also very aware of what they want their kids to wear. So it's more sustainable brands, it's Nordic brands, so we adjusted the inventory based on that.
Mm-hmm.
And then right now we're in a phase where we want to find out if the subscription model works, because right now we don't offer that.
Yeah.
We offer a one-off service, so we allow the customer to choose whenever they want a new box, whenever they want to try it again. So if we see customers keep coming back faster than we project, then we might switch over
to
a subscription.
Might offer to a subscription box. And because if we talk about the subscription boxes, that's sort of a big thing worldwide.
Yeah.
A lot of people are trying to find their niche. Sometimes people do the coffee, and
right.
others do perfume and whatever, or say clothes. So. Why didn't you start off with the subscription model?
Because I also looked at the different trends worldwide, and especially from our competitors that are out there now. They don't offer subscription models. They do that for food, for beauty, but not for clothes.
Mm.
I think it's a lot nicer for a customer as well to not be bounded by a subscription, that they're able to choose whenever they want a new outfit.
There's a barrier as well when you start.
Exactly, yeah.
So you more see it as a sort of next step. If people want, they can.
Exactly.
And it's not a,
yeah.
You started this concept in the Netherlands. You saw some examples in the United States as well.
I did.
Is there? I'm sure you have plans to go international, like
yeah.
every single startup. Are there big differences in how that works country by country, especially in Europe where? Cultural differences are huge.
Well, the next region we want to move into is the Nordics. And actually, mm-hmm. there is not
You're from Denmark.
I'm from Denmark,
all
yeah.
Right, so you know the market there.
I know the market, but there's also not a big difference in consumer behavior. They like the same type of brands. They like to spend the same amount of money. So it doesn't require too much effort from our side
yeah.
to make that switch. But if we want to go to the UK or to Germany, yeah, then that's a longer story.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So why is it a longer story for people who are not in this business? Is it a cultural thing?
It's a different taste. They like different type of brands. They have different type of budgets. It's the whole marketing perspective. Like if you want to move into France, it's different
yeah.
type of tone of voice. But yeah, with Nordics, it's very, very similar to Holland.
Yeah.
So there's not a big change there.
What have you said in your first customers?
Mm-hmm.
You say, okay, you can buy it for, and you can send back whatever you want. So
yes.
What is the percentage? What do people keep?
So here's the interesting thing, because we send around 6 to 8 items and they keep for around 55% of the content, which actually we're kind of outperforming the traditional online retailer. So that just shows that either we hit the mark with what the customer actually wants, or we have a very good surprising factor in the whole concept, which in a sense when a customer orders something, that obviously they don't know what they're going to expect. And with us providing them with that specific taste that they probably wouldn't have chosen themselves, then they might.
Yeah. Like and is talking about children. So, mm-hmm. so is it a, what age range is it? Do you,
right
you
now,
aim at now?
Yeah. Or? So right now we do newborns to 8 years old, and the reason why we stop at 8 is because studies have shown that around
they get their own
opinion, and we want the parents to be the decision makers as long as possible.
Yeah.
Why?
Because they pay the bills.
Yeah. But they still pay the bill for 8, 9, 10, 11, 14
years.
Yeah,
but then, you know, kids build their own opinion of how they want certain things. Mm-hmm. So if we send a box of stuff that the kid don't like, then automatically the box goes back. Whereas if the parent has something to say, they value taste, and they were the ones that actually did the quiz, then we know for a fact they were sending them.
Probably have to do the quiz with the kids.
Probably,
after 8,
Yeah.
What you say you don't have children yourself. Why did you start this? I mean, there's so many things you can do in life. And
that's a very good question. I think I was very much intrigued by the whole curated shopping industry. And I just saw a good potential with kids' wear, because as I said before, it is the fastest growing segment in the fashion industry. But when I also look at other online retailers that offer kids' wear?
There is a market, I understand, and I see that too. But what is your personal motivation? I mean, making money is not the only thing in life.
No, one, I've always been in the fashion industry. That's like my background. And I think I was just bored of just seeing men and women fashion everywhere. And I just saw it as a good potential for me to try and break a norm of the traditional online retail for kids' wear and try and do it more innovative, because there's a big lack in that.
We technology plays an important part of most of our guests here.
Yes.
Which role does technology play in your business?
So that's a very good question. So we want to be more than just a fashion company. We want to be recognized as a tech company in the future. So right now we're in the data collecting phase, where we will build an algorithm that helps us automize the outfit recommendation. So that also allows us to do smart buying, and it allows us to know exactly the type of brands, the type of fit, the type of colors, the type of categories that the customer really wants.
Yeah. And so where are you now in talking about this smart business? So what do you do now?
We're collecting all of the data based on what the customer buys, returns, receives, and the answers that they fill out in the quiz. We're nowhere near in implementing all of that, because it's a very, very long process. Mm-hmm. We would be very ignorant if we say that we would already start implementing that, because we don't have enough data to do that. But it's definitely on the roadmap for the next 2 years.
Yeah. So, what does your company look like? What does your company look like? What is your sort of a personnel? What are the people working for you? What do they do?
So we have a team of 4 stylists at the moment, moms or stylists within the fashion industry. So we have 4 of those, and they basically sit there, they talk to the customers, get to know the customers, and style the boxes manually. And then we have a really cool growth hacker, young guy who basically helps us acquire the right customers.
How does that go? Because growth hacker is a fashionable word as well, right?
Yeah.
But what does a growth hacker do in your case? How does he or she help you?
Right. I think in the stage that we are now, which is still quite early stage, we might not have the funds to spend a lot of money on acquiring customers through the right channels. Mm-hmm. And he basically helps us be more creative in that sense, acquiring customers or keep getting the customers back almost free.
What is it? He?
It's a he.
Yeah. What does he do that you didn't know? It's a new job. The growth hacker wasn't there 4 years ago.
I mean, I have I've done online marketing before, I've acquired customers before, but not to the extent where I can actually think outside of the box and have these tweaks and techniques that could, yeah, take it to the next level.
Yeah. What is the next phase you want to go into with your company?
So we want to create more like a community around the company. So when you think about Bundleboon, you don't just think about, hey, it's just another personal shopping service. But we want to be the go-to place for parents to go to if they need advice on teething or diapers or first day of school, how to deal with that. Basically a community that parents can come to and ask each other for advice, and at the same time get a cool box of clothes.
So do you want, so will they then be still paying me for the box, or
yeah,
will they pay to be part of your company?
No,
as well?
They still pay for the box, and at the same time they get whatever advice they need from other parents as well.
Mm-hmm.
You say you want to become a technology company, but at the moment you say you have mainly stylists working in your team. And
yeah.
I can imagine you have a huge logistic operation because you have to pack and unpack,
yeah,
and
yeah,
have stuff on stock. You have to make deals with suppliers, blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, the technology company is very far away. Huh?
Mm-hmm. Very far away.
How complicated is the logistics in the story?
Right now we fulfill everything from our office still.
Mm-hmm.
Because when
here in Amsterdam?
Here in Amsterdam, in the heart of Amsterdam. Because we want to own as much of the process as possible for as long as we can. In order to understand, you know, the different processes that needs to be changed or that we need to keep going. So, as I said, our stylists, they talk to the customers, they style the boxes, they pick whatever we have in the inventory. And then we have order pickers that assemble the box, put the label on and ship it. And then the rest of us do everything else.
Yep. You started mid-2017. How many customers do you have on average? A week or a month?
So it differs based on how much we put into acquisition, but so far we've sent out around 895 boxes, and the business really started 11 months ago, and 12% of our customers have returned.
How
12%.
12%, and that's not too much.
That's not too much, but we project that every customer comes back with every season, and
okay,
we haven't been alive for that
long. You haven't made the cycle yet.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Oh, that's
so nice. It's we're quite excited to see how it's going to look in the next few months.
Okay, how did you fund your company?
Out of own pocket.
Out of own pocket, okay.
Friends and family and investments as well.
Investments as well, but
yeah,
recently or from the beginning?
A month and a half ago. Okay. Not big tickets,
uh-huh,
but we're now closing.
Informal.
And now we're raising a bigger amount, 250,000 euros. Which we will put into the development of the algorithm and operational processes as well.
Okay. And then probably the moment you decide to expand to the Nordics, you need another round or another investment?
Yeah, well, we can run everything from Amsterdam. We don't have
okay
to have a styling hub in Copenhagen. We can just do a few Danish stylists here and then do as usual.
Yeah.
But do you need, because you said after the quiz, we need to do a talk and etc.
Yeah.
So you're not going to do them in English, right?
You're not going to do, no. But we're going to hire Danish speaking,
yeah.
For example, if we're going to launch in Denmark, we're going to have Danish speaking people.
Yeah.
Okay, if we would invite you again in a year's time.
Yeah.
Yeah. How many boxes will you have sent?
1,700 boxes.
I wish you good luck.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you
very
much.
Wonderful initiative. Thank
yeah,
you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Dank jullie allemaal voor het kijken. En we bedanken, zoals altijd, de biersponsor Bier & Co. De sponsor van de livestream, Jetstream uit Groningen. PQR voor de hosting van de website en Freedom Lab voor de gastvrijheid. We zenden hier vandaan uit iedere dinsdagavond. En dat doen we volgende week dinsdag weer.
Zo is het. Dag.